guys started, how is everything going on project? Because we have less than a month, right? Exam week is
22nd. I think it starts April 22nd.
22nd.
I think that's what it is.
Yeah, it starts April 22nd.
I mean, practically speaking, I mean, you should try and complete it just before that. Right? And everybody should start having a little presentation on reviewing their status of project very soon. We might have that in the next class, we might have that. So here is my proposal, here is where I am passing, right? Okay, so let us go with so who wants to summarize for the structured data here? Because I had asked you to read anyway, you should be ready. Vin, go. You read it, right?
Actually, I reviewed it.
Okay, but we don't know which of the reviews are, so anyway.
Okay.
Go.
So for this, I think the good point that the author gave is like he gave the information like what kind of information to be extracted, like metadata like URL, topic, date, language, and blah blah. And then just throw them into the knowledge base. Then he talked about some ranking. But my question to the author was, let's say, he said that John Proto, he was the writer of New York Times, right? And then he said in the next time, if he see any articles, and if he packs and get the entity like John Proto, then he said that, oh, that is the
writer. Wait, we are talking about the structured data part here. We are talking about the NewsML part here. We are talking about this part.
NewsML.
But when author talks about that Apple example, it completely confused the previous part.
As a reader, I felt
confused. I think his idea might be to use topic, publication, I think there was language, country, or something like that. I suppose too. Probably it might be something like faceted search, but I agree that the example is quite misleading.
The tags that are already there in NewsML, right? What is our NewsML articles? What does it have?
So
it has predefined tab. So meaning, whosoever fills out this document has clear idea of what each of these things mean, right?
Mm-hmm.
topic type in his string, then you know that this is a topic type, right? So there are, what is, how is that exploited? If you had, for example, if you were to discuss a mapping to a known schema, let's say schema.org, right? And so one of the earlier submissions we went through, that person had identified that you'll be doing mapping to new schema.org. So clearly you are going through the tags and asking the question, what that text means, and have a mapping. So whenever I get this information from multiple different sources, multiple different newsable documents, from each of them I will know what that means is mapped. And then if the query context indicates that, if the query has a facet, if there is a qualifier, I would know what would be the context to use, right? I would have additional source for disambiguation. Here, is there a discussion on use of the tag, right? That's the fundamental thing.
They have mentioned that they're going to extract information out, but
does it help?
I think this,
right.
For me, it's too abstract.
Right. It talks about extracted tags. But the other wanted to assign the ranking to the tag, and I don't know how it is relevant.
Even the example is mentioned, like Apple OS and Apple also.
Mm-hmm.
It is not clear also, like, because.
So yeah, how do you know? What is the Apple OS issue coming up here?
Yeah.
I mean, that issue is common to anything. That issue is coming to particularly most relevant when you're dealing with unstructured data. Some text. It's a text issue anywhere. It can appear in the description here, right? If you have a description, there's a description field here. And you can put in the description something which has, and there is something Apple OS, you won't understand. That issue will come anywhere. Specific, what is done to specifically exploit the fact that this is a structured, largely structure, or the structure part of this message or document, right? What is that? Did you make sense of this here? Did you understand this part? Another thing that we can get from the structured data is that so clearly the author knows that this is structured data, right? Now the question is what he or she uses to exploit the structure. You can filter out data on the metadata basis, like the article on a name of author. So there is some attempt here of saying, hey, if what I want to extract is on the author name, then maybe I'll be able to exploit that easily because there is a field called author. So it's a very there's some thought there, but not, you know, it's kind of hidden, not well expressed perhaps. Or do you understand that? You understand that? So it is, as the process, it is pretty clear now how the search engine will process data. Here we need to change the parameter depending upon the requirements of this. It's poorly written, but yeah. Some thought along that line, but I can't fully appreciate it as well. Ellen, why don't you come here and take it up? We are discussing zero EFI, and we are now going to unstructured component of your discussion. supposed to pick up the unstructured.
It seemed, I mean, they had a lot of good ideas, so they kind of what they would parse out, how they build their entities. You know, but it still, it kind of showed, like, we found this, identified these can be like language, they talk about language, country, heading, author, date, so it kind of finds the tags to parse out. And then, it's not like the entities will be used, but it still seems like they didn't really, they kind of put some pieces together, but it wasn't very technical, I guess, or it was still more like a service, how I would do it, I suppose this is how it physically would be working. It was still good, though, at least they point out the tags and how they identify things.
Anybody else wants to hear?
About it, so it is an important issue. But that's not clear, I mean,
how would you really implement that?
Because so many people are approaching that article, right? We are not saying that whatever is in the comments is positive or negative, but it is a trending article, like,
yeah.
That's why it should be kept on top.
So, like, we just cannot. By hearing like all the discussion, it's not just the single document that people have talked about. They have talked, for an example, for the NewsML article, we talked about the article which is annotated using NewsML, right?
Mm-hmm.
So people might be thinking in along these lines. So if we have several document with the comments in order to identify what are the trending articles in this way, so probably they might use.
So even if we want to do that, can we really say that that an article is trending because there are more people commenting on it? I mean, how are you going to quantify what is more and what is
but
less?
But it's another factor, right?
Yeah.
It is a factor that we can.
It's not the only factor.
But how can you include that factor is my question.
I wouldn't include that factor. You can only use comments to give you more background information. Just because it's a lot of people commenting on it doesn't mean it's a highly debated topic. It could be, but you're not sure. It could just be people talking about an ongoing issue. Or somebody comment on it, like, revive a dead thread from like 5 years ago, and a lot of people start talking on it again.
So how do we identify trending tweets in Twitter?
That there would be a lot of people commenting on the entertainment and those sections, those articles more than politics and stuff, because that just tends to be general tendencies.
So this, but my point is, it might not be the only point, but it will be one factor.
So say you crawl for the same similar articles from Washington Post and New York Times and CNN and all of these websites, right? I'm guessing the average number of comments would be somewhere in the same region. It's not going to be 10 comments in the CNN article and a million comments in New York Times. So really, I mean, is it practical to consider this count at all?
The number of comments at least suggest that at least this number of people have read this article. So that way we can measure the popularity of article.
Yeah. How do you compare it to one that for a site that doesn't support comments, for example?
Yeah, that's a different issue, but given this example, I think we should consider.
No, we have to limit down the situation that we have a set of article which have the comments, right? We really cannot compare the article which have the comment and which just doesn't have the comments.
So how does that help respect search engines now?
I think that is only the small part of the comment section, right? Trending, let's say we are not considering the trending part. The other thing that we can get from the comments is the opinions.
Yeah,
in
some,
the article,
have discussed about the positive and the negative polarity
and the negative
of the entities by analyzing the sentiment
that
expressions.
That's even more difficult. I mean, I cannot imagine crawling the web and all these posts. I mean, sentiment analysis There are people who are commenting about the article. There are people who are commenting about people in the article. The way the article has been written, there are so many aspects to the comment and to the sentiments in the comments. I mean, I just don't see it as feasible to do it on the web scale.
So even like we have discussed about image analysis, right? Would it be feasible to train all the web in the images? So I don't think that all of the ideas that we have discussed so far is really realistic in the web.
Okay, so comments can be taken as a part of like a one factor for ranking.
That's
okay,
my
point. So the point here is we're talking about a semantic sub. So what kind of semantic it bring into this?
So semantics is like the, since it's a trending article, because of the comments, you know, so many people are discussing it. So for a semantic search engine, it will know that if somebody is talking about TechCrunch or about this, maybe some entity that occurs in it, if a person is searching for a news or an article of some entity, if they give some entity, so they know the semantic search engine can place it at the top preference, and whenever they ask for some entity, it can show this. Because so many people are talking about it, it will be given more preference. And if somebody searches for some entity in that, it can pull out this particular post. Right?
So what about the relevance of the document? The relevance is low and people are talking loud about it, then and if the other document is more relevant and people are not talking about it, then in that case,
it's just a fashion.
So I'm just comparing, like, if the relevance is high and the comments are low, then in that case, how would we interpret the document?
That depends on how you have designed your algorithm for search. I mean, consider, for example, a Google, and there is one article or there is one web page which is highly cited or highly pointed by other websites, but it may not be relevant to my search, so it will not show. So it depends on the algorithm we design. So the preference should be the relevancy, and after we find hundreds and thousands of articles of that relevancy, we should consider these factors.
I think they factor into two different things though. Because if you look at the number of comments, it kind of points at how popular the website is,
mm-hmm.
or how trustworthy it is if there's a lot of people on it. And then the relevance of the topics may just refine what's on the page,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to how popular it is here. The number of comments is looking at like maybe a big website that has a lot of users and maybe more trustworthy than some just a couple comments. But actually analyzing the comments doesn't really have to factor into that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I think
let's go ahead and read number three now. Of course, unless there was another point, something would have been about two. No.
I just want to tell the author who knows what it is that I just highlighted a couple of things in yellow. In general, this is not very important here, but in future, we really have to improve language things, capitalization, punctuation, the sentence construction, the grammar, that really is pretty poor. So whenever you do this, even if you are native speaker or not, you know, this is not an informal writing. It's an assignment, it's a formal submission. It's not, you know, something you're putting on Facebook or Twitter or something. So pay attention to that, because you make this kind of mistake in your cover letter to a Java, thing, you're gone right there. Nothing else is important. And even not even Java cover letter, even the email you send to somebody you don't know, and you don't do this, so it might as well pay attention now. All right, let's go to the image thing. Please. not seen James West for some time. Oh, you, sorry. Alright, and Kylie is busy.
Extract information based on what the caption was.
Hmm.
Did you talk about Geo? Did you notice that it's talking about Geo? Dr. Zero.
You know, you recall the discussion we had in the last class, right? The use of embedded information, MPEG and other things, right? So I think Alan missed the last class and he would have missed that. Others also, when you guys, some of you send email, can I miss the class? Unless it is a health reason, I would say no, because these are the things you're going to miss. Yeah, I don't think you're going to catch that up as is, you know, if you're not in the class.
So when you search for an image, though,
mm-hmm.
every image has a different header. So
yeah.
Like when you're trying to recover data from a broken Android device, when you try to search like the raw data for the hex header, like let's say you have a tag. Every tag has like TIFF, JPEG, they all have different headers and footers.
Yes.
But they're all linked to the same like camera. So every camera has like the comms they use embeds like a different offset. So when you search for a tag in an image, you can locate those. But does that give you any added image, like any added benefit to it?
Let's step back. First of all, last time we talked about the data that is embedded by, you know, as part of the encoding. And there are multiple encoding standards, but, you know, an example for moving objects, there is MPEG.
Mm-hmm.
So they have defined the model, and the original was MPEG 2, then became MPEG 4, which is probably what is right now widely used. And people have been working on defining something called MPEG 7 and MPEG 21. Okay, so these are versions of that particular standard. What will be interesting is if you study that, and there was a time where I used to work in to study that, is that increasingly each of them are providing more hooks for adding semantic metadata. And MPEG 4 allowed you to describe an object. MPEG 2 did not have ability to describe an object. So in MPEG 4, you would possibly be able to embed a metadata about an object that is in the frame, right? Then beyond that, though, people are in MPEG 7, and beyond that, people are talking about allowing custom definition of domain-specific models. So, like, you know, it could be or it could be schema.org generic model or domain-specific models. Let's say landscape objects or oceans. You know, all the particular model is just created for, let's say, ocean pictures of the water bodies, let's say. And so you can define saying, I'm going to discover the metadata with regards to that is defined here, and this is my namespace. Just like in any semantic document, you'd be calling a namespace which would have described its elements. That same way, in fact, the namespace could be in our file, right, in ontology. So there will be a description for that. And you can pull from there up what those meaning, what the things mean there, right? So mention of this is a ocean water or salt water versus this is a river water and hence not a salt water. All those contextual interpretation will come have a domain specific nature, right? And that can come, for example, from this purpose. So there is one aspect of that. The other thing that I would like to mention is there is a big list that I had seen somewhere. I don't know if I'll find maybe I'll find it again. Can you create a tab and just look for digital photography metadata overview. So you can see now, and you know, just from the table of content, and just if you browse down, you know, further, you can see all kinds of metadata that you can describe for an image. And, you know, you guys can just get. So it should go down here. Like, see here. Now this is the core technical characteristic metadata, right? So this is something that comes from the device. Any sensor that, you know, this is, camera is a sensor, it has, it's a device, and this thing comes there, you know, that way. By the way, I could use a standard like semantic sensor networking ontology as a way of describing any camera and have a better understanding semantic description of this metadata. Let's go down. So you see that, you can see there's some attached GPS receiver, right? Okay, go down. Now see here. Derived GPS geolocation metadata for this image is this. Look at how much information there is. Now, of course, in some cases it will be meaningful to know it is above sea level, and other cases. Other cases it's not meaningful. So, this, but there are going to be so much metadata, much of the metadata may not be useful for a particular application. And that's an interesting thing. Go down. So, keywords here. Now there is a description, right? The full set of searchable keywords and also keywords for the image are, look at that. These are keywords, like tags. Image caption description, flamingos taking flight, Laguna, Amarga, near Torres, whatever that thing, right, in Chile. Now, the other interesting thing is the same issue here, like, go back here, is that, you know, whatever you do, first of all, there is a little bit of structure here. You know, this is a description, that level of structure there. This is unstructured. However, in here, trying to understand, you will do the same kind of things that you do with any unstructured data. So you'll be trying to find out the entities, flamingos. You'll try and find out the location is this thing here. You may find out something like an address even, as a whole. In fact, having found this, you might find appropriate Wikipedia object by using DPD Spotlight, and that might give you a geolocation. Let's see how interconnected the world is and how it is possible to pick up so much metadata. Having done that, it is possible technically for suppose you upload this photograph, it is possible that the software that uploads the photograph asks you, suppose you write a mashup where you can upload your photograph, it'll, and suppose it's able to understand this part because it's a name location and it might be an entity on, let's say, Wikipedia, they'll say, do you mean this? That system can ask that. If you say yes, it can automatically place this photograph on Google Map at the right location. Right? Compared to a human. So recently, I was somewhere in Southern California. I took some photograph, and I went to this site where I uploaded the photograph, and I put the photograph at the location. It was manually find it. I remember which street I was on, you know, overlooking the ocean, and took the photograph. But what if that software automatically allowed me to just give a textual description and then automatically find the location and put it on the map? Then it would be far more precise location, right? Positioning. Go down. These are, again, image-related metadata, right? Cropping all that. And now this is another one. Security or ownership metadata, creator, copyright notice, market, usage. So these are all technical things. These are very necessary for all the professional photographers. When they upload the photograph, whenever they use any tool, they make sure that they assign this, because they are putting copyright. They want this to be copyrighted, and anybody wants to use it, they want to be paid. On the, you go to 500px.com and you'll find most beautiful photographs in the world. And many of them are by professional photographs, and they are only for you to view on the web. If you want to use it any other way, you need to license it. So you're copyright here. Go down. Metadata location. Go on. Where they are, okay. Then viewing metadata. And so these are some of the examples of the tools that display or edit data. Right? So this is EXIF tool GUI. And some of these may be used as a service. So you give me, so like when we implemented our Tali software, right? You remember the Tali search engine that we had done, or audio video search engine? So there where we had images or video, what we did was to use one of these tools, automatically call as a service, give the image to them, and it will read this for us and give it back to you. So then you can, then this is a metadata that you can use for indexing. Go down. Metadata types and purposes. So you can see a lot of other things. Event and transaction, this is very interesting, right? Events or transaction metadata is needed by the software when image is processed. And by the way, this means this is not Google AP Chef Slide Share. Yeah. Go to 46 slides here. Content metadata. Yeah, this one. Question there. So this was a tutorial. This is a content metadata where I started semantic web. This was a keynote, but go back now, not this one. Another one. There's a tutorial on Mystics of metadata, I think this one. So this was comprehensive discussion of all kinds of metadata for all variety of and anybody's interested now in this, I mean, I can take 3 hours to talk about this at the minimum. But you can see a whole bunch of issues about metadata.
Maybe we could look at the last point there, because I think that's what the original question was about. It has some information about the camera, for example. But how is it? What's the use case for that?
The use case for what?
Well, just some of this metadata, like, at least for me,
yeah, so what happens, if I go back here, let me show you one here. So what you will see here is that I discuss a whole bunch of metadata for a different kind of content. You know you are dealing with NewsML, right? There is a, PRISM is a publishing requirement for industry standard metadata. So a standard for interchangeable content description, interchange, and reuse in both traditional and electronic publishing contexts. So somebody who classifies is a member of publishing industry. Who is an example publishing industry? Let's say a financial services company who writes a report on a stock or a mutual fund. That's an example of publishing industry. And they're going to publish the content and they want to be paid for it, for those who use their content. They would use this standard as an example. Right? So when a search engine comes along this line, and then you will say, oh, have they used this standard to describe the metadata? The first example in your assignment, NewsML example, was given with that perspective. Go down, I'll have NewsML here. PRISM Exchange, it gives you a description of this, okay? And it has what vocabulary, DC by the way is Dublin Core, very very widely used standard vocabulary. Go down. So this is about voice content. So this is standard for any voice content, many voice content you can come on the web. People use that. They use this, just like NewsML has a tag, this has a separate different kind of tags. And they use that. So smart search engine, particularly when they are specialized, and they deal with digital media, not just text, they would focus on use of these metadata standards. And they would understand them. and they want to harmonize that. So they may have a internal mass, you know, large ontology in a way, and every each of these metadata standard would be mapped to that. Because many of these things may have location, let's say, but they will have used different tags for the location. The tag that is used for location in NewsAvail may be a different tag than the tag that is used for location for some image metadata. Go down. Okay, so this is MPEG 7. Set of description schema and descriptors to describe the content for multimedia data. And it's a language to specify description schemes. Go down. And you know, there are example applications that use it. So broadcast media, radio channels, TV channels, they use this routinely. Because one, when you want to make an evening newscast and you want to search where I can find a clip of video, then their search engines would be specialized to use this metadata. Next. This is a information content exchange metadata standard. Right? Go down. Let's see if I have used it over here. Or maybe it went on the default Prism.
So Prism was compatible with Prism Alpha.
Okay.
Alright.
So this is all, you know, this has a lot of information about subscribers, subscription, payload, package. So I probably made a comment earlier that a large amount of data in the internet pipes, content you might call, flow in some XML-based standard. NewsML is XML plus. Prism is XML plus. IC is XML plus. YXML is XML plus, right? And that AP News, when it is posted on Yahoo portal, has to pay attention to the rights and subscription and pay. So a typical agreement would be the following, that a consumer goes to a Yahoo portal, types some search query, and some results shows up. Consumer go there to find in good content. How does Yahoo get good content instead of content? If it's open web content, fine. But if, so let's say you go to news.yahoo.com, then it is very important there is a latest content there. Right? When that latest content is put up, that means you need to get that latest content from Reuters, UPI, PTI, AP News, these are all the news syndicators. They create content and sell. And Yahoo is a subscriber. Then when customer does a query and there's a result and customer clicks on content, now Yahoo has to pay. This is one example. There may be pay per number of displays, or it's called impressions, or pay for number of actually clicks and playing. Now what may happen? Well, the way it will be that when that page comes up and there video or image or news story is there, there'll be a banner. So Yahoo gets that banner from another source, which is an advertiser. It's a separate company, maybe Google AdSense. So there are two, three major networks. And for every banner gets played, let's say you get 1/10 of a cent. Whatever that amount is shared between Yahoo now and the guy who owned the content that made this page dynamic page possible. Then you're playing a video. At that point, Yahoo would also insert. Now, either dynamically or statically, they would have inserted that 15-second, like you go to YouTube, you have to see that, advertisement. That would be there. Now, that has a different one. It has a lot more money than compared to, that may give you 3 cents or even 7 cents. and that would have split also with the content, you know, with the content provider, right? So subscriber has to share the revenue for that is made possible by the content syndicators or producers. You see it? So now for that is that ICE standard. And the same way then you go on with the standards for images and videos and all that kind of stuff, right? Within them, you can further embed, the standards can be extensible standard, meaning there'll be a common form, but there may be domain specific form, whereby, so MPEG 7 and 21 would allow you to bring in an ontology for the domain. So suppose this guy is only in the business of selling landscape photographs, and he uses something very specific to that. This guy is only in the business of horticulture and selling the plants and such. So there will be specialized terminology, vocabulary, other things for that, and you can use that also as a part of it. So this is how standards are utilized. Alright. And then it's back to you. So.
Okay, so from that, in addition to the captions, the metadata, well, I was actually pretty surprised at how much metadata some of the image formats have, and so they almost serve as captions on their own. So let's see.
Did you guys look at the reviews and how well the reviews are? Which review is most meaningful? Review is rather brutal, but what about, is that the most meaningful review, or is there, so I think general theme I see here is at least number of you reviewers are saying ideas are fairly abstract, right? I have not heard from Revati, which review is most informative? to rate these, so you, when you, and I'll rate how your writing is. Okay, anybody wants to add anything? Alright, so now we'll move on to a submission by 0F6. It looks bad with you know, the recording going on here and nothing on, right? So if you can pause, you can pause when there's nobody doing it, but that's okay. You might have to edit this here. Alright, so Pramod, did you read this before?
Yeah,
okay, then go.
This guy started with talking about the image analysis part, like he started with the...
Started with the image analysis?
Yeah.
Hmm.
He started with the Tesla, that article, the TechCrunch article.
Hmm.
He started that there are a lot of computer mechanisms through which we can analyze the image and say that this is a car, this image represents a car, and we should use such kind of technologies to semantically retrieve those kind of things.
Hmm.
And he seems to be completely opposed to the ontology concept.
Okay.
So he says that all the ontologies might be very biased in the sense that these are developed by some group of people, so they might be biased.
So I think the question would be, would the Wikipedia be biased? If that is the statement in this thing, I think everybody is entitled to their opinion, except that you are supposed to learn in this class, you know, to make that those decisions appropriately. But one of the often used approach is when you're dealing with broad content, or like on the web, you would ask whether DBpedia that is derived from Wikipedia, as an example, would be biased, people would argue that there is always a bias on those who write. But since it's an open system, and since the others can comment and remove, and there's a lot of arguments that goes, that's as non-biased as it will ever get, right? There is nobody can replace a person's individual opinion, but to the extent that there is a society, in the society, what is a common agreement and what is the common belief, and you know, that is, if you think about ontology means ontological commitment, right? What does ontological commitment mean? Experts who are involved in developing ontology, or it may be in the context of the, and also additional acceptance of that ontology is essentially derived from the fact that users choose to use it, and community of users having selected this as a representative vocabulary and nomenclature and organization for that matter of that domain, representation of that domain, has endowed a certain status to this particular representation, right? So that's how you say that ontology, and then one can always argue that besides the, you know, there can always be a person outside of this thing who disagrees and doesn't want to. Then for that person, this is not an ontology. But even there are vast number of users, and you know, because no, we can't create a system where every 100% of the people in the world will agree to something, right? That's there is no Esperanto and corresponding kind of agreement kind of. So universal agreement is not there, and I think semantic theory does not require Aristotelian view of agreement, meaning this is the truth, independent of anything. It's not; it's all relative in a way. And but given that there's a large community of people and open process that is used, and you know, many people use it, all this gives you ontological commitment, and hence that this is how good it will go. It's as good as, much better, perhaps it is even better than relying on statistics of user queries. Right?
And author seems likes the dictionaries, but he doesn't want to use ontology. Dictionaries are also something that the
Right. So in fact, there have been studies on Encyclopedia Britannica vis-a-vis Wikipedia, right? And Encyclopedia Britannica, which is tightly controlled and realized process, doesn't necessarily come out ahead of Wikipedia. And there are a number of situations where it will be even less preferred than Wikipedia. And it could be even with current and all that. And by the way, you know, as far as I remember, they stopped from creating a published version of, print version of Encyclopedia Britannica. Okay, so that's that. On the other hand, there can also be ontology of facts, like atomic weight of a particle. I mean, that would be a fact. Of course, subject to that particular experiment that I rely on. There will be multiple experiments that can come with different things. But by and large, there will be a lot more agreement there. and then there is scientific truth-based thing. Anyway, so
how do you handle those if you have like conflict?
So that is where the provenance comes from. So in almost all good systems or open systems, you're supposed to be able to know how did you come to this agreement? Where did you get this fact from? What are you relying upon? In theory, you can look up, for example, on Wikipedia, who edited this, who provided this particular part of the text, right? So, and there are systems now, like World Wide Web Consortium has a standard for ontology called PROV, P-R-O-V. And, that would also, that you could use a standard for capturing provenance in detail. Right, so it's an interesting thing. So now this may not make sense to many of our classmates because it's a bit more technical and limited. But see, at the end of the day, OBO Foundry was again a syntactic and structural aspects of ontology definition, right?
Yeah.
And it also had a point of view grounded in philosophical, in the disciplines of philosophy. What do you call an object? What kind of object you will call something? So there is a improved understanding of and uniform modeling. Is something is an entity or a concept or an event? These are all hard questions to ask, and different people will look at it differently. And somebody may have formal mind, viewpoint. Somebody would simply have a very practical viewpoint. So OBO would, give a particular, rigor to that. But that itself is somewhat independent of exactly what is modeled and what actual facts are captured in the ontology, right? So you basically say that, new atomic particle has these characteristics, or you have known, scientific communities agreed that Pluto is not going to be now called a planet, suppose, or not scientific, not the whole community, but the ones who have been given the international rights to be able to make statements about this, then, that would be, based on that, there's still going to be some people who call Pluto a planet, but the provenance of Pluto not being classified as a planet is would be given to that particular judgment that was put, and that would be a provenance, right? So these things can be captured, and how you get that. All right, so coming back to this particular thing, what else? There is a objections to ontology, that's fine. What else? What I will be asking them question is that, fine, if you have an object to using ontology, that's okay. Tell me how you are creating a solution that is semantic or something that is beyond syntactic and structural that exploits, and we discussed in this class a lot about what is semantic and not. So how is that supported? That would be the question I would ask.
He discusses using natural language processing techniques. So I think his answer is based on that. But what is not clear is that he says the search engines should be self-aware, and the search engine should be able to build ontologies automatically. as and when it sees documents. So
then that would be also bias. This is based off the data specific document. You want all the government reserve for semantic.
I don't know whether he's referring to building ontologies based on the word he sees when he does the natural language processing part. I mean, that part is not clear, but...
And he also again mentions that he reviews one ontology. Once the search engine has gathered this information, it will then construct the final search query by and search the ontology it has created and return the answer to the user. I think he is creating the ontology for the query.
I think he's just saying he's going to use NLP to parse out the nouns and then search the nouns in other search engines, existing ones, to find cases about them and then create an ontology automatically.
Interpret the meaning by getting the context, like mean this word as a noun and search in the document and other search engines, and then author says that that is how he is building, but it's not the case. And one more thing is, author makes a very broad claim by saying there is a very fundamental flaw in the existing NLP algorithms, and because of that, he is proposing a new one. So when he makes such a broad claim, I think it would be better if he can describe how he is going to get rid of those fundamental flaws, as opposed to the existing NLP algorithm, which is based on n-gram linguistic method. So it's a broad claim, so he should justify it.
So the point I would make is that anybody, there is no lock on good idea. So anybody can come with a good idea, and it's quite possible that this author has also a good idea. That's not a problem. But at least the proper pedagogical process is that and what Sir C is saying is that when you make such a claim, let it be then, you know, grounded in what's there. Because, like say, one of the things that research, people who do research do is, they are supposed to ground their research on existing knowledge as in published literature, or public, you know, information experiments that exist there, or things of that nature, what has been documented. So people always build upon what is known, what is documented, what is published, and that. So when you make such a statement, I think that the deficiencies of NLP may be quite true, the fact that there will be deficiencies in literature. But there is an issue, because there are so many smart people who have worked for so long on NLP, that just, you know, making statement purely based on the intuition or feeling is usually not a proper science, and not a proper computer science either. Right? So one should look at that. So I would say, okay, I would ask this you know, author, so did you look at What's in a Link paper by William Wood? And the discussion on the NP completeness, theoretically hard issue about NLP that has been widely discussed, right? Again, I recall it in Milton Wood's article arguments, but there are others who have talked about it extensively. So many problems, and there are many papers that discuss unsolvable problems that are not solved by NLP. The problems are very hard, and non-NLP techniques cannot solve. And if you're trying to consider an NLP problem, there are fundamental problems in considering. So that those things are discussed. And the question is, have you come across something that is not already discussed there, and to say that this cannot be solved? So it's that kind of nuance and deliberate approach that typically the science would, I mean, the assignment is okay here, but you know, if you're going to go beyond this thing and eventually write a report or a paper or other things, that would simply not stand. Okay? So it would be a good idea to take a more deliberative approach to such things.
I
Now, when I say n, so when I see as opposed to opening a direct dictionary, ontologies may not be written by a group of people who agree upon common values, but ontologies actually are indeed, then only you call it an ontology. That's the definition. Some arbitrary piece of knowledge representation may not be, that's true. But then I would not call ontology implies, formally implies ontological commitment. Right? There's no ontology without ontological commitment. Just the fact that there's something is an outfile is not an ontology. And that I thought I made pretty clear earlier on, right? So something that looks like ontology doesn't mean it's an ontology. Actually comes from ontology commitment. That does mean that there is a agreement among class of people, whether the developers or users or both, that gives you this. So typically in technical context, it is group of people. And a group of people who are supposed to be expert or well knowledgeable about it, or have a consulted knowledgeable person about it. I think a few of you, who has developed ontologies here? Mary, anybody else has actually developed ontologies, that real ontologies? You did that? Which one?
PO and PO. Parasite, Plasico and Parasite.
So you're involved in that, right?
Yeah. I see the way that the author wrote this, it doesn't sound
louder.
Convincing. So I said that part is not convincing to me because first he said that ontology is biased. Actually ontology is not biased. It's like, so for a search engine, right? So they say that he proposed the automated process for generating an ontology. But how can you generate the ontology? What is ontology? It is a hierarchy of concepts and the relations between the concepts, right? And the restriction like categority or like domain and range, everything, right? You cannot just do it by using the way he proposes. Get the sentence and then use some dictionaries, pass the sentence, like something like Stanford parser, right? And then based on that, you get the part of speech. And based on that, and if you look at the meaning, let's say you look at WorkNet. How do you get the meaning of that and how can you construct the hierarchy, right? It is so vague and it is very much challenging because we human, we read the terms and only the domain expert can come up with the ontology because you know what it means and how it is going to be used. The search engine cannot do that. The search engine, what it does is, it needs the knowledge base like Wiki. The information that Wiki gives is a set of concepts. Also the set of entities of that concept, right? Basically like all of the entities occurs in the Wiki, it was annotated using the concept from Yago. So because of that, the search engine can use that knowledge base, the annotation of that. It cannot come up with the ontology itself. So that is my point.
So I guess my question would be, if the author's saying it's training it, like it's looking for words, like letting other search engines against itself. It's like you type in a word like run,
mm-hmm.
right? No computer knows what that is, right? Like what is that? Is it just a word? Is it an action? But if you parse it out, find out what it's used in a sentence, then you use other like search engines against themselves, so you leverage against it. So you don't write that knowledge database yourself, you use other people's knowledge databases, right? So you leverage other search engines, you get a feel for what run is, right? Run's a verb, people run, dogs run, things run. So you can build an ontology tree that way on the fly. Because that's how we learn as humans, right?
So let's say, what is ontology to you?
Just like you have a word with a bunch of things linked to it. So it's a way
to.
Not a bunch of things, because it's a wrong word. So like, God, this. So you have a word and the work have a bunch of meanings to it, right? A different context, right? So I guess ontology to me is basically like you have a word or a grouping of words or a noun or something, and to that is a bunch of different ways it can be used, right? A bunch of different links to it. Like a, I guess a tree.
Hierarchy, okay.
A hierarchy, yeah, it's a hierarchy. And then from there you basically construct a hierarchy of what possible actions that could take, a word could take.
So can you give one specific example? Let's say like people run or dog run, like how do you create a hierarchy on that?
So you have a sentence, right? Like
mm-hmm.
The dog runs up the hill,
mm-hmm.
Right? If you type in a search engine, it's gonna basically just search a bunch of words, right? It has no idea what that means. So I guess if you look at the sentence, like from an English standpoint, you find the verbs, right? You find the nouns, you find the parts of the sentence that make it meaningful to us,
mm-hmm.
Right? So then if you search for those words and find out what they mean, independently of each other, just by themselves,
mm-hmm.
You start building an idea of what those words could possibly mean in what possible context,
mm-hmm.
Right? So then once you start looking at the context, once you have, you don't do context until you have an idea of what the words mean. You throw away like articles, like the, and you throw away little words, right? But you look at the main words, and then once you figure out what this context are, you can then build your tree of what possible things can run. Then it knows it runs in action, right? You look at a dog can be as an animal, right?
Okay,
so something's moving.
One question, so let's say I give you a sentence like a house running, what would you do with that?
That's not a proper sentence.
But house
running,
don't query
house runs,
right?
So it is a,
yeah,
house
so
is a noun. So
yeah.
How does it know that running, it has to be like some like little
maybe
things, right? How does it, how can you get that from the dictionary or the search engine?
What do you mean running?
Let's say, you say people run, right?
People run?
People run.
People running?
And then dog runs, right? And
yeah.
Then house, run. It doesn't make sense to us, but like, we
yeah,
just...
it doesn't make sense.
Yes,
but
the engine doesn't
understand
that, right?
So I guess what it would do is it would look at run and say, okay, run's an action.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, a house is a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it would try to make an educated guess. And it would
mm-hmm.
say, well, based off what you're looking at and the like the other stuff I've done before, it would spit back some results and say, like, you know, the House of the Senate, there's a running for somehow. Like, it just basically puts those things out there. And then you say, no, it's not right. Like, maybe I wasn't looking for that.
For making accurate, I guess you need to have rules.
Yeah, maybe just go through and basically be like,
so
I mean, you always
how
have
many rules you can, there will be plenty and plenty of
rules. Well, I mean, you can have infinite number of rules, right? I mean, it's like, as you keep building your ontology, right? You say you get a bunch of rules, how many rules do you want before you kill it, right? Like, if you put a whole, you have a billion rules.
Yeah, how would you know that you need to apply this set of billion rules in the current ontology?
I mean, you could put a cutoff, right? Basically let it run through a couple, whatever cutoff you want, say basically there's no possible way that you can have these two noun and verbs and sentence that come across a cohesive argument.
I think you misunderstood the ontology concept. So what you're saying is more of like building the knowledge base, a set of facts, more than that. So let's say, because ontology means like, what are the terms in, like, let's say being used in the domain, and then
yeah.
Are the possible relationships that they may have the restriction on the terms being used in the relationship. It is very like conceptual agreement.
Mm-hmm.
But what you are saying, it is more of like getting a set of documents, and you are trying to build a document by trying to build a knowledge base, or I would say I'm not sure it is a knowledge base, but a set of assertion.
Yeah, assertion.
Right. So, but the problem here is we need to use the ontology because we know that, let's say you got a name, you want to know that if that is a person or an organization. If you just, let's say, given any like any text with a name, with the, let's say you have a noun in that, there's no way you can know that it is like, let's say, name of a school or name of the some agency, right? But using the ontology in that, if they have all of these concepts and some, let's say, wiki, from there you can extract all of the entities, that of person or of school, and when you are running the search engine, you would utilize that part, the knowledge part.
True, if you weren't leveraging somebody else's search engine to your own. Like,
because if
so
you
I'm not built, you wouldn't build it from the ground up. You're leveraging somebody else's. So you just type, since you're using Google, Bing, another one to use, you wouldn't have to worry about, they already have their knowledge base built, right? So if you have a noun or a name, you just throw it in there, let it search for it. You're not building them. You're basically
that
leveraging an existing search engine against
so
for your
purposes.
So that
is just for syntactic search. It doesn't include any semantics in it.
It would just search multiple ones for you. So you just give a name, right? So you just give a name like, right state.
Mm-hmm.
Right, what can that be? Right, you have no idea what that is, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you're saying if you have an ontology database, you would have terms linked to it, like university, right, school, the concepts,
mm-hmm.
right, linked to it. Yeah, so that would be your ontology, right? But if you're not worried about having your own background, you just basically have a search engine that basically you put it in there and you search another one,
mm-hmm.
search a bunch of different ones and see what those respond back. Then you get a feel for what it is.
Oh, so does your search engine is like you are reusing?
Yeah, reusing somebody else's
reusing
existing
the
word.
Existing search engine.
Yeah,
so what is this semantic search engine here? What you by the mean? So what is the meaning of you saying that your search engine is semantic search?
Because you're using their knowledge database to build.
They don't give you the knowledge, they just give you like set of like millions results related to some
yeah,
term.
But it's so you didn't have to do that legwork to get it.
Which label?
You didn't have to go through and write the web crawl or something, like query all this page and give them a rank. Right, so you're using somebody else's work, they've done like, they haven't done the hard work, they've done most of the work to get to that point. So you're just using their work.
So
instead of designing your own web crawler, designing your own thing to search the internet, use theirs.
No, the question is that you need to build a search engine.
So
how would you build that?
That was how you didn't say you had to build from ground up. Like you build a search engine by using somebody else's search engine.
But here we are saying that how do you build the semantic search engine?
By using somebody else's search engine to get your submit to get to start building.
So what is
semantic
that semantic that get you?
Okay, say that like we say like the dog brands, right? So we search on Google, Yahoo, and Bing. We get a bunch of documents, right? So then from those bunch of documents, how are you going to interpret anything? Are you going to follow the same approach that the author mentioned to read everything in the document? Identify nouns, verbs, and I mean, how do you assert that dog is an animal, it goes to this hierarchy, runs, is the action? How do you get that? The results given by those search engines, they are a set of documents, right? You
mm-hmm.
won't get anything else.
That's true, you just get a bunch of documents, so you basically parse it through.
You pass it through using the same.
Using the same kind of method, you keep going. I mean, you have a cutoff, right? There's got to be some point where you stop, right? You don't just keep going forever. Right? So basically, it's like maybe research would use the top 5 hits from each web search engine. Right,
so
the top
still,
five.
How do you identify run is an actionable thing from those type of documents? How?
We already know it's a verb, right?
Okay.
English,
it
right?
may be a noun.
Not in that text.
Okay, let's say it's a verb. So then how do you come up with that it's an actionable? Like something actionable, something event or something. How do you guess that from the documents given by other
searches? So let's say it spits back a picture, right? Because Google Image sometimes throws back pictures, right? When you do the image analysis on the picture, you see there's people in there, right? Okay, that's good. As you start to go, people move, right? There's people in the action of running. And it's like people moving, right? So like you see people like standing still or let some kind of like arms up in the air, maybe they got some kind of like running gear on. But you just see people and the fact there's people there. So you start feeling that it's got something to do with people. Then like another picture is a doll.
Okay,
moving.
That part that is you are doing, not the search engine that is doing that work.
Yes,
right?
So
because like most of the thing is like in your thinking. How do you make it like algorithm so that the
that's
engine
easy. Does it make an algorithm to discern people from like images? That's simple.
So it is very easy for one term, but let's say given a couple of documents and you don't know about that specific term. Even if you read it, you don't understand.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to be super easy, right? It's not easy. Mm-hmm. It's not possible.
The thing that I didn't get about this paper was, I guess, just the image processing. Because, I mean, from what I understand, it's pretty easy to
So we should wrap up here, but I guess it was good to see some of the discussions here and arguments. I'll ask one rhetorical question. Look at these two things that I share with you. Yahoo's search engine and what they are doing. Look at what Bing is doing. And then ask me, tell me, and look at, to some extent, what is GKB? It's an ontology of sorts, right? What is Freebase? Freebase was created by human manually by collecting data and disambiguating it, right? And you may be aware that Google recently released, I think, 40 million entities, disambiguated entities, right? What does it mean? Having disambiguated meaning, there is an agreement. Ambiguity means there's not clear understanding the multiple possible choices of what something means. Disambiguation means there's an agreement. And then these are clearly being applied to the search. So right there is an existential proof of what is being done in using in going well beyond. So if you look at discussions from Google long time ago about use of semantic technology and why they don't believe in it versus what you see now, you clearly see that, right? If you are really interested, you can go and look at this article I had, I think it was in 2007. Let's see, was it here? Yeah. Right. So there was an article by Peter Norvig. He was a director, and he is a very, very well known machine learning person. His book is widely used for AI. And he said ontologies are no good. The same way I think you saw in the last. And this is my answer there. And then it gives you a certain argument, and then you can go and compare with how Yahoo, Google, and Bing are all using background knowledge. Right? I don't think anybody is using OWL ontology. That's as I made it very clear. It's not OWL. It doesn't have to have OWL as a language for a person. It does not even have to have description logic as a language. Ontology starts with common nomenclature or vocabulary and having an agreement. So you can call even a taxonomy of terms to be an ontology, right? But the power is on having a lot of knowledge that is organized, that is disambiguated, and there is community endowed. There's an ontology commitment. That's what ontologies are. These are exemplified by Google knowledge base of sorts. These are exemplified by getting the names from LinkedIn. Now, on the LinkedIn, there are several people by my name, right? And yet, each of them are disambiguated, right? They all have different URLs, and then they have different skills. They are disambiguated, right? So, when you then go and see this here, Bing, they are using LinkedIn information for people, right? What is the chance that somebody does a people search and that person is represented as a unique entity on LinkedIn? That's fairly good, actually.
But what if the person is not on LinkedIn?
Right, but that's notice my question. Chances are very good that you'll be, if you're searching for it. Otherwise, it's also fine. Otherwise, you can go and it will be pure search, and they will not be disambiguated, right? Right. So in this case, look at this. See what, for information. Look at this here. Where did it come from? Yeah? That's not, so for the person, that is an ontology, right? Now the fact that you are noesis recessor, you will probably show. That's why I tell you to create your web page and, you know, LinkedIn and link connect with me and all the stuff. So these are the power of networking. All right.
I have one question about the Google knowledge, right? Because they say they did not release that, they did not make it open, accessible, right? So in that case, I'm wondering, like, let's say if they have a knowledge base and they say what kind of relationship they are utilizing in their search engine. Like, is that only added type? Let's say given one entity, we know like what type is that entity or like other relationship as well?
I think we have a lot of information. Let's talk it after the class here because that's what we need.